I'm going to show you how you can use any old Raspberry Pi and a BBC micro bit to do some quite cool data logging, dishing up a nice interactive graph like this that you can host just on your local area network quite simply. So this is the kind of graph you can expect to produce. This is a live graph with data coming from outside. I'll show you the setup in a moment. The blue line are temperature readings from the micro bit's onboard temperature sensor. They're just in whole numbers of degrees centigrade. The orange line is showing you readings from an external temperature probe, which gives more granularity, so we've got a slightly more sort of wavy line there. You can do all sorts with these graphs. You can zoom in to different regions if you want to examine them. If we just go back to the home setting, the other neat thing you can do is you can click on individual lines on the chart, and you can isolate individual lines if you just want to look at those on their own, which is quite nice. And it just runs on a Raspberry Pi and a micro bit. So let's have a look at the setup outside. So it's not quite a Stevenson screen, but if we go down the side of our house, we've got like a lean-to kind of shed. And if we go down this end, amongst all the garbage, we have got an old Raspberry Pi Model B and a BBC micro bit, connected to which is an external temperature sensor. And the Raspberry Pi is receiving serial data from the micro bit, with temperature readings from the micro bit's onboard temperature sensor as well as the external one. It's just been sent over the USB cable to the Raspberry Pi, which is then dishing up a web page just using Python with a graph on it, so you can plot and see the temperature changes over time and see how the weather is affecting us. I'll show you how it works now. And here is that chart, and if I refresh it, we may see it's just updated. There we go, we've got another reading appearing here. So the temperature went to a high up here at around 2:30 this afternoon. It's now creeping back up again. Let's have a quick look at how it works. All the code you need, by the way, is on GitHub. I'll put a link below the video so you can find everything you need. The first place to start is by putting a makecode program on the micro bit itself. It's a really simple program. This is all it does. At the start, it redirects a serial output to USB. This is probably not needed. I've just put that in for completeness and to make it absolutely clear what's going on. And I created a little function to log data. So every time it logs data, it flashes a heart on the screen. And all it does is write a string on the serial output. So I've joined together two strings, one with a temperature in the internal temperature reading in degrees centigrade, and the other one is the light level in this case. And it does that about every minute using this every loop here, or when you press button A, so you can test it by pushing a button. I've also got a link on GitHub as well to the version of the project that uses the external temperature sensor using Bill Seaver's DSTemp extension, which you might want to have a go at if you fancy doing that. So let's have a look at how it works anyway. So we've got this makecode program that we've just described. All you really need is a Raspberry Pi and a micro bit and a USB lead. So you flash the makecode program onto the micro bit, plug it into the Raspberry Pi USB socket, and then you need to put a couple of things on the Raspberry Pi. Now, to get it working manually, just to test it, it's very simple. You only need two files, really. First one you need is this serial read file. Again, it's pretty simple. In fact, that line there, import HTTP server, it's probably not even needed. What it does is it opens a serial connection to the micro bit, which is almost certainly going to be at this address. It's going to present itself as TTYACM0. Sometimes it doesn't. If it doesn't appear there, just unplug the micro bit and replug it and maybe reboot the Pi. But I found it always seems to appear there. And all the program does is once a minute, it reads the serial input. And if it gets some data here, what it does is it creates a date stamp, which I've truncated, so it's just the date and hours and minutes. I'm not interested in seconds. And then it just writes data to a CSV file. All it does is write a timestamp, the temperature in this case, and the light reading. That's all it does. And the other file you'll need is you'll need a blank CSV file, which in this case literally just contains, like, that's it, if I can find it, what's gone off the screen, the words temperature, time, temperature and light. That's all it contains.
So that's you'll need the empty CSV file, otherwise you'll get an error. And the other thing you need is the HTML. Now this is where all the clever stuff goes on. It uses a library called Plotly. If you don't download and include the main Plotly JavaScript file, you'll need an internet connection, because this is just pulling it off the web. And then it's got a function in here that basically what it does is to draw the graph on the screen. It pulls in the CSV file, pulls out all the data and plots it in a nice way. You can choose what shape you want the lines to be. I've used spline here. It gives you a curvy line. You might want to use a straight line. Linear is the option to use a straight line, which I did on the version where I've got the temperature coming from outside. So it's a very short file. There's not much to it. It's quite simple. So you put the HTML file in a folder on your Raspberry Pi. You put the serial read file in the same folder and the test CSV file in the same folder. And then spin it up. You'll soon find it starts logging data. But to actually get the graph to show anywhere as a web page on your network, you need to start a web server running. And I've got instructions on the GitHub page for how to do that. It's very simple using Python. So what I did to test it out was in one serial console. I got the program running that does the reading of the serial data. So I typed Python 3 serialread.py in a terminal console. Because I was connecting remotely by SSH to the Raspberry Pi, got another serial window open, another terminal console open, and spun up, navigate to the folder where all your files are, and spin up a web server. Very simply, I didn't realize you could do this so easily in Python. You just type this instruction, Python 3, -m http.server, and then a number here, which is going to be your port number. You can use pretty much any number you want. And then if you point your web browser at an address which would be either the name of your Raspberry Pi on the network, mine happens to be called CFAX, but you might have an IP address here like 192.168.0.2.3 or something like that, put that in a colon and 888 or whatever port number you chose, you'll see your graph. Now I've automated mine now, so mine works a little bit differently. So on my network, it comes up at a slightly different location now because I've automated it. Instructions are on here. I added some lines to etc. RC local to spin up the serial read program, and the web server, when you plug in the Raspberry Pi, it starts itself automatically. It means it's now dishing up everything pretty much that's on the file system on the Pi. So the path is a little bit different. So now if I go here, I can see this is live data coming from my Raspberry Pi out in the lean-to. And you can see it's dishing up at that address. It is dishing up a lovely graph that will just keep updating as time goes by. I've also added a button on here as well, so you can download the CSV file if you want. So if you want to just examine the data, it's going to open it in a spreadsheet. But there, I can actually get the raw data in a spreadsheet if I want to examine it at any time or do anything else with it. There we go. I think that's quite elegantly simple. You've just got a little bit of Python. We've got a little bit of HTML with some JavaScript in it and a little bit of MakeCode. And we've got a rather nice little system here that's just chugging away, remotely monitoring temperatures outside for me, putting it on a graph so I can view it anywhere when I'm on the Wi-Fi network in the house. You could do this obviously without a microbit, but the added flexibility that the microbit gives you is that you could create your own network of data loggers. You could put microbits all around the area, around the location, inside and out, sending data, sensor data, by radio to the microbit that's plugged into the Raspberry Pi. And you could be plotting all kinds of different data in here about temperature in different rooms, or light levels or sound levels if you're using the microbit V2. There's sort of no limit to what you could do. Or you could use the magnetometer, for example. Maybe you could attach something to a Raspberry Pi to a weather vane and use the compass to see which way the wind is blowing, if there were any wind. Or you could attach a magnet to a door, for example, and use the magnetometer to sense whether doors were open and closed, so you can tell when people have been shutting and opening doors or windows. There's all sorts of things you could do with this. One other thing I did as part of this project in preparation for it was to do an experiment on the using the normal Microbit V2 built-in data logging feature. Do check that out. If you've got a Microbit V2, it's got a great data logging feature that enables you to record data on the Microbit itself, which is non-volatile. So if your Microbit loses power or you unplug it, the data stays on there and it produces data in a nice little chart like this with a visual preview. Now, the reason I'm showing you this one, this is an experiment I ran indoors overnight where I had a Microbit connected to one of those external temperature sensors, and I logged over time, over a period of a few hours, the temperature from the internal sensor and the external sensor. Now, I've always assumed that the temperature readings from the internal temperature sensor was going to be much higher than an external one, and in fact this is true at the moment. If I look at the temperatures coming from outside, there is about a 3 degree difference in the two, but I think this is because I originally placed the Microbit outside. It was very close to the Raspberry Pi and it got very hot and it hasn't really had a chance to cool down properly. When I did a fairer test, just leaving a Microbit and a temperature sensor side by side on a desk in a room overnight, I found that actually on average statistically there was no difference between the readings. The internal temperature readings, obviously they're more they're less granular, they're only whole numbers, and the external temperature readings are more precise because they've got decimal places in them. But what I did is I popped all these in a spreadsheet and I averaged them up. In fact, let's open it up. So I popped all these numbers in a spreadsheet and did a little average of the difference in the final column. And when I did a sort of average of the difference, I found actually, statistically speaking, no difference at all, minus 0.01. In fact, the internal temperature was slightly lower than the external temperature over the period of a few hours overnight. So statistically, no difference at all. So that was quite an interesting experiment. So even if you don't have an external temperature sensor, this tells me you can still use the Microbit's built-in temperature sensor to do some interesting data collection.